Hey, baie welkom by Fietsfiks, episode vir Augustus. Ek is Etienne Driek, ek sien by Cycle Lab in Fourways, waar al die kennis is met wie ons gaan gesels. Ons gaan vandag een bietjie focus op jou gewig. Ons gaan kyk na die sogenaamde hard ride training. Ons gaan met David Marie ook gesels oor die 947 en jou oefenroutine wat nou reeds aan die sterkant van die winter moet begin. Sit terug, ontspan en morgen gaan jy raai pad slaan met baie meer kennis en wysheid. Kom saam met ons! Ons is in Augustus maand, wat beteken minder as 120 dae voordat ons by die 947 uitkom vir 2017. En wat vir my beteken is, jou oefenroutine moet nou reeds begin, want ons is aan die sterkant van die winter, en hoe vinniger jy fiks word in die winter, hoe makkeliker gaan September vir jou wees. Maar ek sê hier om vir jou te vertel nie, David Marie, professionele fietsryer, geef jou 'n bietjie meer raad oor oefening aan die sterkant van die winter, en hoe om jou fiksheid op te bou vir 947.
Ja, wat baie nice is van hierdie tyd van die jaar. Ek dink ons is baie gelukkig. Die weer speel die laaste rukkie nogal saam, so ek dink die mense het baie verskonings om uit te kom op die pad nie. Dis sonskyn meeste van die naweke so ver. Hoopelik is die ergste van die winter agter ons. Maar nou is 'n goeie tyd. Ek sou sê as jy kan uitkom oor die naweke, dalk 'n bietjie langer ure insit oor die naweke, altyd as mense 'n goeie fondasie bou, is dit baie makliker om kan ek sê op te bou van daar af. So dis nou kan ek sê dit is belangrik om nou al bietjie te begin, net om in jou fiks uit te werk, dat jy lekker sterk kan begin, ek sou sê, September, Oktober, November, wanneer dit bietjie belangriker begin word.
So moet in ag neem, baie mense is besig deur die loop van die dag, mense het werk en goeie, so sê jy sê, kom ons sê, iets soos enig iets tussen 2 ure en 4 ure per week vir jou gewone weekend warrior, sal genoeg wees vir Augustus om jy te begin?
Ja, verseker. Ek sal altyd, moet ook nou nie probeer om die hele 4 ure op een saterdag of een sondag in te werk nie. As jy, ek dink dit sal beter wees om 'n half uur elke dag te doen. Dit sal baie meer voordele hê. 'N half uur elke dag boor 4 ure net op die naweek. So dis die ding. Ek sal sê, elke dag, al is dit 'n half uur, 15 minute, net ietsie om jou aan die gang te hou. Dit maak ook het baie makliker as mens die Vrydag sê 15 of minute of 'n half uur ry. Saterdag, wanneer jy jou 2 ure of jou 3 ure ride wil gaan doen, is jou bene baie, ek sal sê, meer oop, jou bloedvloei is beter, so dan voel jy ook nie so sleg vir die eerste 15 minute van jou saterdag ride nie.
Augustus maand, traditioneel eindelijk een winderige maand, so is daai maar eindelijk een klein added bonus vir die ouens as hulle begin oefen, want jy het die weerstand van die wind ook?
Ja, vooral vir ouens, ek oor die kleiner oukies is, ons nie te mal oor die wind nie, word bietjie rondgeblaas, maar oorspronklik vir baie min die mense wat in die platteland, in die Vrystaat, plek is soos daai, die wind waai regtig rof daar so, maar hulle het nou weer nie klimme nie. So as jy nie die klimme het nie, gebruik die wind. Windweerstand, soos ek sê, is net so goed soos om regtig klimme te gaan oefen, so partykeer is dit nodig om jou halfuur te ry tot by Suikerbosrand of so 'n plek nie. Gebruik die wind, dit is daar om te help. En wie sê, as 947 omkom, dalk waai dit die wind 'n bietjie daai dag en dan is jy reg vir dit.
Baie ouens gaan uit op die pad, hulle ry, kom ons sê, enig iets tussen 10 en 15 kilometer, so hulle cruise eenvoudig net. Is dit genoeg as 'n ou begin oefen om binnen daai spasie te bly, of moet jy uiteraard gaan en jouself probeer druk so ver as wat jy moontlik kan gaan?
Ek sal sê, afstand is belangrik vir nou, vir Augustus maand en tot September, om dalk ry dalk bietjie stadiger as wat jy normaal weg sal, maar probeer dit vir daai klein bietjie langer te hou. So gaan daai 5 km ekstra, maar probeer dalk die tempo klein bietjie minder bring. Dit maak het makliker vir jou om later te bou op die afstand. So meeste van die professionele ryers, ons doen ek sê langer ure in Januarie, Desember en dan ook weer in Junie, Julie. Langer ure om die fondasie lekker sterk te bou vir wanneer ons begin ons meer intensiteit doen nader aan die belangrike wedrenne en dan kan jy dit sterker opbou.
Baie ons het in seker die fiets weggepak vir die winter, die kouer maande, dalk die indoor spinner gebruik, so is dit nou dalk die perfecte tyd om dalk ook Sankelab toe te kom met die fiets om in te boek, laat hulle net bietjie dienst doen op die fiets en kyk dat alles nog 100% is op die ouse fiets.
Ja, vooral baie van die fietse, vooral ook op die mountainbikes, as hy vir die hele rikkie staan, die tubeless conversion gaan pap, die sealant word droog, en vir die fietsrounds ook, die tyres begin maar bietjie perish as dit vir 'n rukkie gestaan het. Ek sê dit is verseker belangrik om dit nou al, ek sou sê die fiets reg te kry dat jy weet hy's reg vir die volgende 3 maande en dan die laaste, ek sou sê 3 weke voor 947 om net weer in te bring vir die laaste check-up dat jy seker maak jou race is 100%.
En van 'n span perspektief af, 947 is 'n belangrike wedren vir julle hierbo. Julle span het julle al begin met julle julle oefensessies vir 947.
Ek sê ons fokus op 947 net begin die dag na Augustus in Maart maand.
So toe die mense weggewaai het.
Ja, so dis hoe groot 947 is. Dit is regtig dis een van die belangrikste wedrenne van die jaar. Ek sê dit die Amashowashowa in Durban en 947. Dis maar die 3 grootste wedrenne van die jaar en die groot fokuspunte. En ek is seker almal het al almal wat regtig belangstel om die race te wen. Het lang al een focus gestel op dit en op begin van dit.
En nou vir een stukkie pret. Leon Kraus die Trek 2018 bekendstelling in Mildersdrift by Avianto bygewoon.
Mr. Yuki, mm-hmm. I think we start off first of all, what thought goes into the design of a mountain bike?
It's a heavy question. The thought that goes into any mountain bike design is we start with the rider and what goals the rider may have in his or her ride and what she wants to do with the bicycle. From there, we try to use all the tools at our disposal to meet every need that rider may have. So whether that's a full suspension bike and the suspension design, the fit, the angles of the frame, it all starts with the rider and we make every decision based on that.
And obviously that said, with the rider, today's time everybody's riding, so you've got from the beginner straight through to the racing snake and elites. Obviously the design between those do differ.
Will differ based on category, but we find that what the really fast person wants is also similar to perhaps the person who's not as fast who wants that same model of bike. Kind of a generic answer, but what we found is that as you move up in price, perhaps we'll detune the bike and make it more friendly for a more entry-level rider.
Fantastic. Now, that said, obviously, determine price. So what happens is, now we get to the big question. Aluminium versus carbon. Now, obviously, pros and cons.
Weight. So I'll answer that in sort of a generic industry way, saying that carbon has the fewest compromises other than price. It is a more expensive material to work with. It requires a lot of hand labor. It requires a lot of upfront work with coming up with the layouts and how the bike is going to be constructed. Aluminum does that too, but what we found for a given price is that aluminum could be the best material or carbon could. There are also components that are much better to be made out of aluminum versus carbon. For example, a rocker link on a shock, we actually make that out of a magnesium alloy rather than carbon fiber because we can hit the weight and strength we want to with that component.
Fantastic. Mm-hmm. Now, obviously, another question, obviously going through to carbon. Mm-hmm. Now we get to the point, is lighter or is bitter?
That's a good question. It depends on who you ask, I think. So if you were to ask a cross-country racer at the highest level who just wants ultimate performance, lighter is almost always better. If you were to ask a rider who is more focused on durability and who wants to just have something that lasts as long as possible, lighter may not be better.
What has been, let's do it another way, what has been the biggest change in this last 5 years, or even the last 2 years on the bike design?
Okay. So I think there's a lot of technologies that have changed the way riders use their bicycles now. One being dropper posts have become much more common. One by drivetrains is another one. And shocks, meaning rear shocks and forks, have gotten much better. And it's allowed riders to ride over the same terrain at a higher pace more comfortably.
Fantastic. Then we know, and in South Africa specifically, mm-hmm. cyclists are brand conscious. Mm-hmm. And with that goes trust. Mm-hmm. So we know and understand with Trek, mm-hmm. the whole, you've got your lifetime warrant on your frame mm-hmm. and everything. So trust, obviously a big component of what you do every day.
Yeah.
Do you have any further comments on trust specifically in the workplace and obviously your day-to-day processes of designing a bike?
Yeah, I would say that our test standards, a lot of bike companies say this, but we have many test standards that we put the bicycles through that are above and beyond what the industry requirements are. And because of that, when I see Rachel Atherton hurling herself down a mountain, I feel very comfortable. Because that's a bike I engineered. So I know the tests are at a very high level for that bicycle, so she's safe.
On a basic day, mm-hmm. your Trek team says, listen here, new bike.
Uh-huh.
What would that process entail? Where would you start?
Okay, good. So where we would start is, we would start, like I said earlier, we would start with the rider and his or her goals for the bike, and then next, we would lay down a list of parameters that coincide with those goals. And then we would get to doing the drawings and deciding what's capable for the design. It starts with a two-dimensional, just hard points drawing, we call it the center line, that determines things like head tube angle, bottom bracket, height, shock position, things like that. And then from there, we'll go through and actually do 3D CAD. But that process that I just explained very quickly is several months. So
I could agree something.
Yeah.
Kyk, met die 947 op pad het almal van ons nou lekker geëet in die winter, wat beteken, jy moet nou in Augustus maand hieraan begin werk en dit so klein as moontlik probeer kry. Onthou, hoe swaarder jy is, hoe moeiliker gaan jy trap. As jy byvoorbeeld op 'n fiets is en jy dra 2 liters by jou, dan gaan jy bietjie moeiliker trap. Maar as jy daai 2 liter bottels afgooi, dan gaan dit makkeliker werk vir jou. Dit is nou gewig gewys natuurlik. So kom ons gehoor by Debbie Nathan wat jy kan doen om eerstens gewig af te skud in Augustus maand en jouself op so 'n manier reg te kry dat jy optimale gewig bereik teen die tyd wat jy 947 moet ry hierdie jaar. Debbie, less than 120 days to go, 947's on the way. We all, well, not all of us, but I certainly have packed on some winter weight. But now is the time on the tail end of the winter to start dropping weight. How do I go about that?
That's everybody's question, all of us. Most of us tend to pack on, even if it's 1 or 2 kilos, anything more than that is absolutely forbidden. So the 1 or 2 kilos, as one emerges from hibernation, what you generally tend to naturally eat less stodge. You're not looking for stuff that's really so warm, so the idea of salads is more appealing. And basically, you actually just have to get a hold of yourself, have a talk to yourself, and stop eating so much. None of us get away scot-free, and everybody responds differently to different. Some people know that they've overdone the sugar, which is bad for all of us. Some people know that they've been having somehow bread or pasta at almost every meal. And other people are just eating more. You have bigger helpings. It's more comforting, makes you feel good. And one tends to have a second helping or more. So often it's not such a radical decision as more putting on the brakes a bit.
In terms of dropping weight, a lot of people will resort to diets, diet this, crash diet this, and they usually crash, myself included, halfway through the diet. But there is a lot more scientific way of looking at a diet, and that is a swab in the mouth and DNA analysis, which pinpoints to the problem foods in your life, right?
Well, it pinpoints to a lot of issues in our lives. Some of the time one actually recognizes it almost as a personality trait somewhere along the way. But there are so many different diets out there and books and things online and tweeting about this and that. And people tend to feel like a failure when what's working for 10 other friends is not working for them. And you tend to go, what is wrong with me? Why can't I do this? And actually, it's not that. It's that you are eating perhaps one or two ingredients that you deemed to be healthy, but are not actually going to work for you when it comes to weight loss. So what I do is it's a field called nutrigenomics, and it's your nutrition based on your genes. So I'm not a doctor, I'm a nutritionist, so I'm not there to diagnose and predict actual full-blown illness or things to come. This is putting a pattern of risks together and working out what could be maybe improved. Well, mostly there's always things to be improved, but stuff we wouldn't normally recognize. And sometimes I have with clients taken away two things from their diet and the weight's just fallen off, and they were deemed to be like the right healthy type of snack, but not for them. Some people tend to have very effective fat storage genes, which come from billions of years ago. It was how the species kept alive. Those people who learned how to genetically modify and store fat, those tribes survived. Unfortunately, in this century where everything is freely available, none of us have to hunt or gather to find five berries. And mostly we are overfed. And a lot of us are eating too much prepackaged food. And certainly if you want to lose weight and be healthier, takeaway food really is a no-go zone.
The so-called refined evils of life.
Absolutely. It's almost like back to the farm, if one could be so lucky, but back to cooking. And we are all so stressed and so busy, and there's not that sort of the cellular family that all sat down together at particular times for meals has broken up. And people are so attached to a device while they're eating, they're not even aware of what they're eating. So it's also a sense of being mindful about this meal you've prepared or are eating and the people you're sharing it with, which is mostly your family. And a lot of the time, no one's even talking to each other. They're looking at a device or they're watching a television and are not sitting down and aware. They're just putting the same oversalted, usually, food into their mouth.
Sad. If my mouth is being swabbed now, what is the process from there?
Fairly non-invasive. It literally is a mouth swab, like CSI. We're looking for skin cells, genetic information from your mouth, and that is sent to a laboratory in at the company I work for in Denmark. That is about a 2-week turnaround time for results, and then you kind of sit down and we go through all these weird names and make it into an understandable source of how to eat food that's going to really benefit and either help sort of suppress some things that are firing on the wrong side of right, and also to turn up expression of some genes using food, and and it's definitely not going to be processed food.
Hoe werk heart rate training en hoe weet jy wanneer jy in die regte sogenaamde heart rate zone is? Dis nogal 'n moeilike ding om te doen. Kyk, jy kan gaan Google en gaan uitvind en 'n raai speletjie met jou hart speel as jy gaan oefen. Maar die beste is om by professionele mense uit te vind presies wat is heart rate training en hoe moet jy dit verstaan? Ek is hier by Cycle Lab in Fourways, so kom ons gaan hoor hoe werk daai hartklop oefening. Computer.
Okay, when you're looking at a cycling computer, you need to be able to know how far you've been riding, for how long, at what speed, and then overall will be you want to be able to summarize what have you done for your ride. So you need to know how long did it take, let's say your time, you need to know your speed, your average speed, your maximum speed. So those will be your basic function from a computer. From a basic computer, you will be looking at an H20 from Garmin, which will give you all those basic functions. And then from there, if now I need to know my heart rate, so while I'm riding, I need to know how effective I am, then I'll move from the H20 to an H25, which that computer will be able to give me my heart rate. And at a later stage, if I want a cadence sensor, I'll be able to add a cadence sensor. So those are gonna be your basic function for someone who just want to start and also want to know the heart rate, want to know the cadence. The cadence, we're talking about the RPM, which is your rest per minute. So you need to be able to know how fast are you pedaling. So those are going to be your two basic computers from that point of view.
Is buying cheap necessarily the best option? Because you will have someone come in and say, oh, that one is R1,500, so I'll take that one. Just purely based on price, and then he gets home, might not be what he's looking for. Says, is buying cheap necessarily the best option?
No. You need to figure out what's the most important thing for you. So if the most important thing for me is heart rate, speed, cadence, and your distance, then you go with the basic one. But if power is important, so let's say I want to know my power output, then you move from the 1,500, let's say, to the one which is 5,000 Rand, because that unit will be able to be comparable to a power meter.
And quality costs, I mean, if you pay that amount of money, you will get a performance kind of bundle that suits you and the heart rate monitor. And I just want to stick to that as well for a second. How accurate is a heart rate monitor on one of these?
They are very, very accurate. You're looking, I'll say, from 90 to 95% accurate. For me, that's the most important thing. So I need to be able to know how my body is reacting while I'm training. It doesn't help for me to train at 100 reps per minute, but my body's taking the pain. So you need to be able to know which training zone you need to train in. Then you'll be able to know whether you're doing good or you're doing bad.
Is Garmin still the front runner? Because we have got Garmin here, we've got Polar, and we've got Wahoo. Now, a lot of guys swear by each of these products, but if you read a lot of reviews, you'll see that Garmin pretty much comes out on top on most of the reviews. So are they still the front runner, or is it pretty much a level playing field?
To me now, other guys are coming into the playing field. I would say Wahoo, they're doing very, very well in their GPS computers. When you look at the Element and the Element Bolt, they will kind of like go with the 820, not with the 1000, but for me, now while we're starting to do well in bicycle computer. Yes, Garmin, they've got a variety from the bottom of the range until to your top end, whereas Wahoo, they're just starting with kind of like middle of the range. But for me, Wahoo is coming to the fourth, and then they're doing very well with their computer.
Can we assume that within the next decade, all of these brands will be on a level playing field in terms of what's available and the type of technology that they put out?
Not really, because they're just following what Garmin is doing. To me, that's the most important thing. Yes, Garmin might take other ideas from other brands, but for me, they're still ahead in terms of cycling computers. When you look at your cycling computer, Garmin, for me, they're still there in top for me. And then I'll say, secondly, I'll say Wahoo is coming to the fourth as well. So that's me personally. I'll say Garmin, they've got wider variety of cycling computers, as well as their sensors, which makes it big difference in terms of what they offer in the market.
And then last question, in terms of heart rate and heart rate training, would you say 75 to 80% while training is a good heart rate to be at?
Correct. So you need to, it also depends on what's the main idea for you. Are you want to burn more fat? Do you want to get more fitness? So it will differ. For me personally, when I want to train from 70 to 80% of my heart rate. That's the most important thing. But for someone who just want to lose weight, they will train according to 60 to 70% of heart rate. That's where they burn in more fat compared to someone who's a racing snake. Then you want to race. Then you want to train at zone 3 and zone 4, which is a different training zone compared to someone who want to burn more fat.
Nou ja, dis dit vir hierdie episode. Baie dankie dat jy by ons aangesluit het. Volgende keer maak ons weer so. Stuur vir my e-pos Etienne by rsg.co.za. Veilig ry.